For almost 4 years now, I've been using the LG CX48 TV as a monitor for my Mac and PC. I believe it was the first generation of OLED TVs at this size, and many, including myself, opted to place it on their desk rather than their living room. Great contrast, color accuracy, and those inky OLED blacks paired with the 120Hz refresh rate made this TV a gaming and productivity gem. But early this year, I started having trouble seeing text and details clearly. Granted, the 4K resolution stretched across 48 inches was never crisp at just 92 pixels per inch. OLEDs, especially from that generation and at this size, also suffer from something called text fringing, which until recently I didn't seem to have an issue with. But I am getting older, and the local cemetery has started to flirt with me every time I pass by, but I'm not ready to push around any daisies just yet. It was, however, enough to push me towards a change, one which initially started with sensible choices, like expected candidates, such as those tasty-looking ultra-wides. But then I had an idea. What if I did something really stupid, something that makes absolutely no financial sense? Instead of getting a modern screen, with modern features such as a built-in KVM switch, what if I tried to get two Apple Studio displays instead, and tried to connect those single input screens to my two computers simultaneously? Well, not only did I ruin my financial forecast for 2024, it actually worked. Almost. So the goal is to connect a MacBook Pro and a PC to the two studio displays, while being able to seamlessly switch between them. Add to that the requirement that I wanted to keep all of the display's features going, that is the integrated webcam, speakers, and more importantly the built-in USB hub. The first problem to be solved is that the studio display is made to be used with a single Thunderbolt connection, which is great if you only use modern Apple computers or a laptop. Everything can be powered through that cable, right down to charging, which is really neat if you're looking for that one cable solution. But I was not. Following the traces of Thunderbolt, however, the first idea was to get an extension card for the PC, as mine only has one HDMI and three display ports. However, that would have required constant replugging whenever I switch between the systems. There are Thunderbolt switches, but they are all very expensive, and in the light of having purchased two of these monitors, I was keen on trying to not punish my wallet any further. So what connection possibilities are there then? Well, if you ever googled on how to connect a studio display to a PC, it's not going to take long before you eventually end up seeing this thing here. This is a USB-C to DisplayPort cable with an included USB-A for all the additional data. From hence on forth, I shall call it the Jangly cable, because it jangles around due to it having an additional Jangly USB-A portion attached to it. Basically, you connect the USB-C portion of this to the studio display, and then connect the display port as well as the USB-A cable to your source device. Does it work? Yes, and surprisingly great too. The speakers and the webcam just worked out of the box for both Windows and Mac. Although center stage Apple's fancy let's focus on the person and crop into the image feature is software based and stuck on macOS. However, there is a way to get it to work on Windows as well, but I'll show you that later. There was a strange issue on Mac though, that depending on which USB hub or adapter I was using, it would simply not work. I ended up getting this little one from Satechi, which seems to do the job just fine, but connecting the cable directly or with another USB hub just didn't work. In the end though, everything went through and I can't tell the difference between Thunderbolt and this Jangly cable, which is fantastic and exactly what I was hoping for. Since the Jangly cable also ends with a DisplayPort connection, it opens up the doors for another idea. You see, when I'm making a YouTube video, near the end I usually switch between macOS and Windows on a constant basis, because I edit the video on PC, but prep all the metadata, create a thumbnail and other things on macOS. Now wouldn't it be cool if one of the studio displays would show the MacBook Pro and the other the PC? Well, of course, and we can do that, with the help of one of these. Or actually, two. This is a simple 2-to-1 DisplayPort switch. Now, what this allows me to do is to connect the studio display's DisplayPort from the Jangly cable into this switch, which I then feed into the MacBook Pro and the PC. Let's visualize this in order to make sure I get this across properly. We got two systems, the MacBook Pro with Thunderbolt ports and the PC with DisplayPorts. For the target, we got two studio displays, with each of them having only one Thunderbolt input. Using the weird Jangly cable, we feed the studio display's Thunderbolt or USB-C to the DisplayPort on the DP switches, then we connect the DP switches via a DP to USB-C cable for the MacBook Pro and a regular DP to DP cable for the PC. In order to get the data working, we take the USB-A cable from both Jangly cables, one for each studio display, and connect those to a USB switch. This one again feeds into both the MacBook Pro and the PC. And wha-bam, multi-system studio display support achievement locked. I honestly can't believe that this ended up working. I was sure that I would eventually run into some issues, which there are, but I will get to those in a minute, but for the most part, it works great. I can now seamlessly switch to the PC with just a press of a button, and with the help of a little software called ShareMouse, whenever my cursor crosses over to the other screen, it automatically switches my peripherals and vice versa. I gotta say, I'm a sucker for novel things, and this is pretty darn novel. I also sticky taped all of the switches under my table, and I really mean everything, so changing between the systems is really easy. This way, I don't have to lift my buttocks and I can firmly expand my bottom half until I turn into a human blob, much to the disappointment of my Apple Watch, which keeps trying to get me to move. On the software front, things don't look as bad as I initially anticipated either. Officially, Apple doesn't support the studio display on Windows machines, which means changing brightness and color profiles cannot be done. What happens is that whatever brightness or color profile you select on macOS will simply be taken over to Windows. You cannot change it afterwards. Well, not quite. And Mr. Nadim Kabesi, which I've hopefully pronounced correctly, is a much smarter person than me and wrote a brilliant little article explaining how he got everything working on Windows, and it's super easy to replicate. You see, Apple actually does support the studio display, but only on Macs running via bootcamp, which is Apple's way of running Windows on their hardware. For those cases, they actually do supply drivers, but how do we get a hold of those? Well, with the help of another brilliant person called Timothy Thuton, who wrote a little application called Brigadier, which pulls all the necessary drivers from Apple's update service, and wha-bam, a second time, Houston, we regained control. Not entirely though. Brightness and being able to change the color profiles is on Windows now, but True Tone and Auto Brightness are still absent. The same goes for Center Stage, but as Mr. Kabesi pointed out in his article, Nvidia Broadcast will do just the same and even works with any webcam as long as you have an Nvidia GPU. Lastly, if you only have a Windows machine, I want to point out that potential firmware updates to the studio displays are not possible either, unless you connect it to an Apple computer. But everything else, including the USB hub and all the fancy 5K resolution at 60Hz, works just fine. And yes, gaming on it works too, but it's not that great. The image looks beautiful, but you're gonna have to deal with some tearing, especially if you have the hardware accelerated GPU scheduling turned on in Windows. You can disable this under the default graphics settings. Some games also look a little better with VSync turned on, some don't. For anyone who plays any fast-paced shooters or needs to have even the slightest bit of competitive advantage, these are really not for you. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to get Nvidia Surround working either, which lets you use both monitors for a visual surround experience. I think it has to do with the fact that the monitors are being driven by a single DisplayPort cable. If anyone has an idea on how to get this running, I'm all ears. If you're more on the side of a console player, it can be good enough though, but connecting the studio display is an additional challenge again. The same company who sells the Jangly cable also makes one that ends with an HDMI connection. I didn't try it, but there is one from Club 3D that is supposed to work. I did have an active HDMI to USB-C adapter, however, I was stuck with running the PS5 and Xbox Series X on 1080p, which isn't so great. The lack of HDR also made the visuals look far less appealing than what they could look like. The speakers supposedly don't work at all with any of the solutions, so even if you get it running, it's not a fulfilling experience. We have to remember though that these were really not built for gaming or entertainment, these are mainly productivity monitors. Let's wrap this up with some other issues that I've been having and see if it was all worth it in the end. I've now been using these monitors for almost 2 months, and in general, I love it. My eye issues have all but disappeared, and it might sound a little esoteric, but it's really calming looking at these compared to the LG before, and so much more relaxing. The higher pixel density also reaped in more productivity benefits. Apart from looking tack sharp, working on audio is fantastic when you can see every little waveform detail. Sometimes this almost feels like the switch from SD to HD back in the times of the television, or how the kids like to say these days, TV. However, not all is perfect. It's close, but there are sometimes issues. For example, when the screens turn on, occasionally they get recognized in the wrong order and end up being flipped horizontally. Since the screens don't have a physical off switch and switching the input source doesn't seem to do anything, I have to power them off, which in my setup actually is quite easy as I have everything connected to a Hue power socket. Of course, I have the controller for this taped under my desk as well. This way, I can reset the studio displays with a physical button after all. This is unfortunately also needed when I switch back from Windows to macOS. For some reason, macOS just doesn't like it when you come from a Windows machine. Funnily enough, switching from a PS5 to macOS doesn't seem to be an issue. Only when it's Windows, the studio display remains black. But like I said, a power reset will fix this. Occasionally, the peripherals also don't get recognized, but a simple toggle on the USB hub will solve this as well. You may also have noticed that during the power on process, the right studio display seems to be just a little bit brighter. I honestly don't know what's going on here. Once they are on, both look absolutely identical. It's just during the launch where the right one looks kinda bad. To be honest, that one is weird in general. It's like the neighbor's cat who keeps wandering into my flat but never wants to be petted. What's the deal with that? Anyway, the weirdness continues. The Thunderbolt cable it came with also didn't work, and the guy I bought the screen from gave me another one instead. The original cable is also slightly longer than the one that came with the left screen, which I also bought used, but from an actual store. Again, I have no idea what is going on. Maybe this is just an earlier model, but whatever the case may be, I just hope that it doesn't die on me anytime soon. Speaking of dying, the Jangly cable was quite a torture to buy as well. The first one got lost during shipping, the second one arrived dead and didn't work at all, and finally the third one worked. This gave me a bit of a scare earlier on as I thought my experiment failed, so if you got one and it doesn't work, send it back. It's definitely the cable. Another thing that keeps dying if not properly being taken care of is the MacBook, as it can't be charged through the Jangly cable. You need to supply an additional power source. Which I have, of course, taped onto the underside of my table along with the MacBook Pro, because remember, I taped everything under my table. Everything. But more importantly, how did you find everything? Do you think this setup is worthwhile or a giant waste of funds that could have been achieved with a much cheaper alternative? Actually, I can answer that myself. It's a clear yes. However, novelty and the curiosity of wondering if this would actually end up working played a big role in my decision, and in the end, I'm really happy how it turned out. I'm not saying anyone should do this, but if you were contemplating about the possibilities, here's proof that it can work. In terms of improvements, I would get an additional USB switch. At the moment, the integrated hardware features only works on one machine at a time. Using a second switch would solve that. But maybe you've got an improvement idea, or just a comment on the whole ordeal itself. Whatever it is, let me know, and as always, thank you so much for watching. I hope this was a little fun to sit through, and thank you so much for sticking around till the end, and see you in the next one. Bye.